handing it over to invisible cashiers, attracting the attention of Dayglow security, walking out with her unbagged goods. Sister Gertrude says it's a terrible business. None of us can even spell kleptomaniac. Wouldn't be so bad if the hots were some use. Gertie prays the sweet Lord will forgive Mother her itchy fingered transgressions. Brother Richard has another one of his migraines, swears little Susie's perfume is going to make him hurl. It's bad enough spending Sundays in the lounge, wretch, she says, without having to suffer him moaning and groaning all night long as well. Dad's still another runner, ditched work, said the day is dawning, got to get out, murder all 9 to 5 sludge, going to live on a desert island. Yes, he really is all washed up. Me, I'm just biding time in my bedroom. I'm a little man with a simple plan, but execution is painful. That's what it says on the first page of my diary. Wrote it in my sleep, which I do a lot these days, to escape my crazy family. Thanks very much. As Mark said, yes, I am a spoken word artist of some sort. I've been doing this for a good 10 or 15 years now. But just to let you know a little bit more about me, I've produced a series of kennings. There's a poem that some people learn in school called a kenning, where you write a list of adjectives to describe a thing, a person, yourself maybe. This is just a little list of how I might describe myself, what I am. Morning pager, professional winder, porridge eater, Ribena drinker, mountain biker, music lover, bus hopper, biscuit porter, dummy spitter, journal keeper, avid Facebooker, geriatric longboarder, poetry slammer, stanza shaper, indie publisher, rule breaker, manic ranter, audience scarer, dust shaker, garlic dodger.
Yeah.
And the garlic has something to do with the look. My partner calls me Nosferatu's brother, and she often says that I don't like very much either. My name is Steve, I don't like both things. But I do like opposite things, especially eating. This is called yesterday's lunch. You had the choice of chips and gravy at Lipton's Cafe, or bacon butties from Doran's at the bottom of Park Road. You could cram your coins into the Kit Kat machine, or maybe take a packed lunch. Foolishly, you risked the school food. That queue, always a mile long, and always some sort of sadistic streak to flick your ears, or pull your hair, or just generally try to throttle you. And of course, you'd be the one wanting to bop him on the nose. You'd be the one waiting in line innocently, hoping there'd still be curry or fish left 1 minute, then forced to the back of the evidently delinquent queue the next. At Benfield Side Comprehensive, a blazer was expected. Good for carrying cutlery in the breast pocket whilst hands clasped the slippery tray. Otherwise, just dandruff enhancement. And the school tie was another cause for consternation. The only time you want something this tight around your neck, sir, is if you're trying to hurt yourself. And I wouldn't trust one of these stripy little red and grey stripy numbers to bring me release. What, boy? My office, now! Of course you wouldn't say that, but who hasn't thought of the ultimate escape route when raging hormones wreak havoc on personal trajectory? Collection of free meal pads from Chief Monitor would be another reason for persecution by the rich and nasty. But not Susan, surely. Call it inverted snobbery, but someone so drop-dead gorgeous, so elegant, such a princess of the dining hall, could hardly possibly come from an economically challenged family. After 30 minutes of thuggery and romantic speculation, came a vile splat of cold mash on a cracked plate, followed by anemic cabbage and a glob of gravy from a steel jug with skin on top. Pudding might be half a shortbread biscuit and the scrapings of the semolina urn. I ask you, Gateshead, what on earth could possibly be more appetising?
Yeah, thank you.
Cheers. Just some more little memories. I made a little pamphlet that's available over on the merch table last year for National Poetry Day. The theme of National Poetry Day 2014 was Remember. So I just strung a bunch of shorter memories together. I'm just going to go through a few of those for you. I remember manual typewriter nights in the 90s, Tippex fingers, concertina cut and paste, staple manuscripts, living like a hermit, cranking out pages at the drop leaf table and loving it, reading small press magazines, submitting poems, getting A5 envelopes through the letterbox. I remember revolting blue bell bottoms in junior school, a green zip-up cardigan, hair that could snap combs, totally self-conscious, not wanting to go to school, feeling inadequate, not wanting to be part of it, wishing I could live on a desert island, playing with my toys. I remember Evel Knievel's sunpipes that never did half the things the one on the advert did. Not once did mine ever loop the loop, and no one could get Evel to sit down properly in order to make the bike do a wheelie. I remember the chopper and the camper van. I had the racing car that turned into a dragster with a parachute. I remember the Annan sisters running along Melbourne Street whilst I was waiting to see Doctor and the Medics at Newcastle Riverside in 1986. Then saw All About Eve, Jane's Addiction, Sonic Youth, Fugazi, Lydia Lunch, and was once ushered in by Chris Haskett of the Rollins Band, never expecting to see the Beastie Boys eating their tea.
Cool.
Funny, I can't remember what happened 5 minutes ago, yet still I keep scribbling, ranting, and hoping to be doing so long after this poem. Thanks.
Yeah.
This next piece came from a writing workshop. Sometimes we do these big all day writing marathons where we just throw a load of writing prompts in the middle of the table and someone picks one up, reads it, and everybody writes on a theme for however long, 5 or 10 minutes, 15 minutes sometimes. And this prompt of this particular round was, did they fold the end of the toilet paper over? Write about the first time or the worst time you stayed in a hotel. Forget hotels. After away gigs, real hardcore rock bands sleep in bus shelters or behind wheelie bins in sleeping bags on top of cardboard boxes when it's snowing real hard on a Saturday night in Sheffield. Or what about that time in Leeds under the steps near the potty with a novice rope sleeper, showing them the ropes, getting the best cardboard, running around the back alleys by the bins behind department stores, large fridge boxes or washing machines. And speaking of washing, come sunrise you feel like you've been dipped in silt, eyes red raw and a migraine like someone slowly driving a Black and Decker drill bit through your left socket. It's creepy, yo, the good old days. Now, it's guest houses all the way, like the one again in Sheffield, that on the website was supposed to be 5 minutes from the city centre, but everyone you stop to ask for directions looks at you like you just stepped down off Neptune, back and forth, back and forth. Try flagging a taxi, they'll have you blaming all. So it's another bus ride back to the train station to give the driver at the taxi rank the address for a destination, which is actually someplace way out in the suburbs where you're greeted by a landlord whose only concern is how to get an unspecified consignment through customs and the rigmarole he's had trying to secure a visa. He doesn't show you to your room, he just wants your take on the situation. And to cap it all, he's deaf in one ear. Sorry, was that 2 lumps or 3? Mind if I fart?
Yep.
You're sitting at a rickety old kitchen table, its vinyl top covered in breadcrumbs and tamash, and it's like, maybe the bus shelter would have been a better option. I don't care if they've lost your passport, I just want a key to the room. I'm not a customs officer, I'm here to see Marilyn Manson. And speaking of darkness and dark arts, this next piece is called Sigil Sammy. A sigil, as Wikipedia kindly informed me, a sigil is a symbol used in magic. The term has been used to refer to a type of pictorial picture of a demon or other entity. In modern usage, especially in the context of chaos magic, it refers to a symbolic representation of the magician's desired outcome. So with that in mind, it's a lot to take in. Here's a little piece called Sigil Sammy about an apprentice magician. Sammy sits among scraps of sinister imagery, supposedly sending signals to his subconscious. He tries not to see the dismantled words, makes bold strokes across canvas, but isn't sure he's on the right lines. All the science there is, all the magic there isn't. Sigil Sammy doesn't have a clue what he's getting himself into, but a method actor has to try out all the options. A mixed up kid with an ego of epic proportions. Heavy metal heroes adorn his bedroom walls, pentagrams and goat holes. Sitting in a mess of self-induced confusion, riding to the end of ecstasy, he wonders if what he wants is what he'll get. Sigil Sammy tries to blot out reality, but the din and disaster of a mundane society ring loud and clear in his tinnitus ears. Sigil Sammy just has to ride the hurricane, and if all his dreams come true, he'd have no one but himself to blame.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure about this next one because I don't want to clear the room, especially not for the young people. I've got a poem for young people next, but this one's for their parents. Anybody sort of looking forward to September? Parents. Parents that aren't teachers, Jim. Anyone looking forward to September?
Yeah, me.
You are, okay. I was on a bus this morning and someone said, I'm hoping that there's not going to be many children in the Metro Centre today, and I thought, no, it's a Saturday, it's going to be full of children. So this is a piece about, it's called Lessons from the Voice of Experience, and it's directed more towards naughty children, not good children. He will learn, among other things, how to enjoy personal sacrifice. Like Jenny Eclair said in Grumpy Old Women, all children should be believed that their Xboxes, their £80 Reebok trainers, their iPads, internet connections, and dial-a-mum taxi services, and be expected to sit on a wall, kicking their heels against crumbling brickwork, bought to bits for the entire 6 weeks holiday. He will learn, among other things, how to find enjoyment in simple pleasures, such as helping Grandad to creosote the back fence, the lush aroma of tin and brush, clogging his airway. Asthma, my big toenail. Nothing the matter with you. Can't pull the wool over my eyes. I might be 68, but I can still run rings around layabouts half my age. He will learn, among other things, how to enjoy the way sunlight falls across a beige carpet. How at other times it illuminates the far wall and allows him to find his shadow, upon which he will be prompted to consider how lucky he is not to have to endure the indignity of 2 years national service. He will learn, among other things, that silence... is indeed golden. And no amount of AC/DC, Eminem, Pussycat Dolls, Led Zeppelin, Girls Aloud, My Chemical Romance, or Cradle of Filth, Roundup 211, will convince us otherwise. Eventually he will realise that he is not the be-all and end-all, not the centre of the universe. He is a hooded youth, catapulted through adolescence by raging hormones and the egging of his obnoxious peers. He will learn that life is no picnic. Go ahead, sunshine, scoff while you can, because after the summer holiday, it's solid ground every step of the way. Thanks. Thanks very much. I didn't clear the room, so that's okay. I was a bit worried about doing that poem. I run creative writing sessions, not so much in schools, but I do sometimes work with school children. And one of the exercises I like to do is automatic writing, which is just kind of playing with words, seeing where they go, not really thinking too consciously about what you're writing, just letting the words flow. And this next piece is an example of that, and it kind of explains what it's about as it goes along. I took a line from the poet Ian Macmillan, the Yorkshire poet Ian Macmillan. He hosts The Verb on Radio 3 on a Friday night. He writes a lot for kids, and I was flipping through a children's book of Ian Macmillan's, and one of the pieces had a line, Jack and Jill went up to fish. So I took that as a starting point, and I mean, what on earth could that lead to? Jack and Jill went up the fish. Well, maybe it led to something like this. Jack and Jill went up the fish to wear some strawberry jam, but Mary didn't quite know what to do with the insects in the bottom of a pan, so the stove stayed cold and the jars were empty on the back of an ostrich in the shoe coming under the stairs. When Jack found out that he'd wasted his journey, he was livid. I could swim for that Miss Contrary. She'll get a piece of my toenail if she lets me down again. You're at it again, dear. Calm down. It's only a nonsense tale. He's actually a pretty good writer. He just wants to see what sort of response he'll give. So don't believe him when he tells you his head spills raspberries and rotten tulips. It's all just hogwash and a spin dryer. Spin dryer? I'll spin the swine if I catch hold of him. He'll wear the sole of my shoe on the other side of his scrawny neck if he can't come up with something a bit more sensible than that. It's meant to be nonsense, Jack. Don't you see? It's taking things from different places and bumping them together to make interesting patterns and unlock the subconscious. The sub what? The subconscious, dear. The conscious brain sometimes needs to be stimulated by the subconscious. I don't get what you're spinning on about, Jill. Well, listen, you know when you have a dream and silly things happen like that one you told me about last Thursday? Oh, the one with our Michael eating a Wellington boot while skateboarding through a street of elephants. Yes, well that's the sort of thing you sometimes tap when you tap the subconscious. All he's doing is latching onto an image and an idea and running with it. Well, it all sounds a bit stupid to me, says. You're saying that Mary didn't have a valid excuse for not having a job full. Not only does she not have them full, but Mary doesn't even exist. She's just something he conjured up in his imagination. So you mean we've come all this way up the fish for nothing? Jack turned round to see a turnip on a roller skate. I could just eat a nice big fish with chips, but I haven't got any money on me. No pocket see. Takes me all my time just to stay up on this roller skate. I don't believe this, says Jack. I'm going down the hill. Everyone around here is bonkers. Wake me up when the kettle's boiling. It can be sometimes dangerous tapping the subconscious when you're writing. Sometimes some very dark things can come up, but usually for me it's just silliness. I have a dangerous habit when I'm out walking about. If you were to ask some of my friends, they'd tell you. When I'm walking about, I tend to veer towards the curb. I don't know why, but I just seem to gravitate towards the curb. And there's been numerous occasions where I've had to be pulled back in out of the path of oncoming traffic. City centre buses in particular, another layer of pain and there goes your arm, so to speak. So that's like one impulse for writing the title poem of my first book. And another, just getting old I think, mortality creeping in. This is called Tightrope Walker. Armed with grief and two bags of shopping, trousers too short revealing crusted navy socks. I walk behind myself 20 years from now, dirty anorak flapping in the breeze, shiny dome poking through chip pan hair. What am I thinking as deck shoes shuffle over grey blocks? Do unborn children's voices ring loud and clear as my shape burns into the road? Or just the echo of a wife's laughter, still mocking this long after my departure? Armed with grief, a clown moves slowly forward, spits onto the curb. Overtaking this balancing act, I discover no face, no body inside the shabby clothes. Strange air slips through the fibres and travels the concrete wire above the surface to which he's gone. This is quite a new piece. I have a little pamphlet being published by a press in Middlesbrough called Blacklight Engine Room Press. And they pair up two poets and give them sort of 10 or 20 pages of poetry each in a little pamphlet, and four stories. So this is a little flash fiction, and it's quite grim. It's called The Scrawl. Tommy lived up the road from our Beverly on Valley View. He was a short kid with thick, dark brown hair, holes in his cardigan elbows and a sole flapping on his left sand shoe. Sometimes he wore wellies in summer. Sometimes he punched people for no good reason. His sister had a baby when she was 14. His mother killed his dad with a carving knife in a drunken rage one morning when she came home to find Tommy and Tommy's dad in bed with a milk glass. Tommy was always going to be trouble, trouble with a capital T, and you'd be wise to steer well clear. Tommy's cousin had been in Boston for stealing a load of pushbikes, some from people's gardens, some from their houses. But the most audacious haul had been Wild Wheels on Swindon Road, lifted the new rally range, boxer, striker and grifter from the display window. Apparently, he'd been casing the place for weeks. Deirdre Robson never forgave hubby Donald for not setting the alarm that Saturday night. Easy as Kett from the school tuck shop. Tommy once tried to make friends by offering to buy us all fish and chips. Pull the other one, Tommy. It's got knobs on. No, I tell you straight. I've nearly whispered through the letterbox. I've nicked a tenner from Avril's purse. Avril, the gullible auntie, would open her door to any waif and stray during the summer months, buy rounds of ice cream, even offer her bed to some of the more hot-blooded young men, or so they say. Tommy, though, he'd steal cat's eyes from the road, sell his granny for tab money, and charge extra for delivery. We hated the little sod. We hated everyone, but at least we didn't end up hanging by the neck in Franklin. No, we were good little boys and girls, and now we're here in Christ. Work till you drop. Tommy was a dipstick, but at least he knew the score from the outset. This country robs you blind.
Hey.
In a back street of twisted mechanics, where the curbstones are crippled with grief, lives a woman with eyes like dark diamonds and a smile that's beyond all belief. She's got trinkets and tales of deception locked in a Bible of sand on the tip of a poisoned umbrella that some traitor has placed in her hand. And the silken garment of torture worn by this lover of germs will destroy all the joy once worth sharing, as the scabs on her face do confirm. Now your body is riddled with anger, all twisted with poison black lies. If the mornings you find here the harvest, the reflected weak form you despise. Thanks. That's quite a dark little piece. As I said earlier, I go to lots of writing workshops. I run them and I go to some. This next piece was written at a workshop in Newcastle, run by Apples and Snakes. Apples and Snakes are the largest promoter of performance poetry and spoken word in the UK, and we're very lucky to have a regional coordinator in the North East who programs loads and loads of events, whether it's in education, in schools, or just putting performances on around the region. And this came from one of the workshops. The workshop was about writing on the body, and this was actually just the warm-up piece, but I prefer this to the piece I wrote later in the session. So this is just a little two-minute warm-up arriving at a creative writing workshop. And it's just a diary entry. 15th of May 2002. I am unfit, just running along the street this morning. I thought my knees were going to crumble. Passing the bag from hand to hand, I thought my wrists might snap. I used to be quite energetic. I used to ride a BMX bike, could tic-tac on a skateboard from the Rose and Crown all the way up Park Road to concert without taking a foot off or pausing for breath. Now, I collapse just cycling round the block on the granny ring. My nerves are jangled, my belly is getting flabby, and I don't like the tension in my right leg. Hamstring too tight. And don't even get me started on body memory, those 6 abdominal exercises done daily from last June to October. Can't remember a single one. I rode 65 miles over some of the most difficult tarmac down a big ride to find last autumn. Now I can't even make it to the bathroom on time. I am a physical wreck, but still have the behavioural problems of a strutty 17-year-old. I hope my wrist holds out for the duration of this writing exercise. Maybe I'm a hypochondriac. I do hope so. I hope next month I'll be doing backflips off the bus shelter. I hope I'll be riding sea to sea in 3 days easily. But somehow, I think it's highly unlikely. 10:02 a.m, settle down cafe, Apples and Snakes, writing on the body workshop. sorry for the pause, just needed a little drink for this one. Just water, not the hard stuff today. My drink of choice used to be caffeine. Actually, used to be coffee. I used to drink about 20 cups of coffee a day. And coffee and poetry go together like peaches and cream, but caffeine-fueled creativity isn't without its dangers, as we're about to find out. This is called Wired. It's the way your brain's wired up that determines how you play the game. Pull up wild leaps of the imagination, dance the tango on a pinhead, dazzle with lightning flashes of inspiration, convey emotion, truly communicate with sensitive souls and make impressions on those challenging you to impress. It's the damaged circuitry or dodgy process of inputting data that determines whether you'll reach the manic peaks of delight or be a lonely, slothful child whose only solace is making others feel totally ill at ease with their surroundings too. Profundity or morbidity, ditch the instruction manual, grab a copy, a screwdriver and some elastoplast. Dr. Frankenstein, this is your life. But some days can be so slow, you just want to throw a firecracker through your own letterbox to liven things up a bit. Order a massive takeaway, then refuse it point blank and say, kebab me and chips, I'd rather chew my own ribs. Put a ghetto blaster, if you still own such an antique, on the pavement with a tape of unholy Norwegian black metal cranked up to 11, till the speakers distort and the neighbours are spitting their own verbal poison, threatening fisticuffs and peace intervention. Drain a cup of mud and curse because you go down one every 5 minutes, unless a grinding migraine sends you crashing to the floor. It's the way your brain's wired up that determines how you process all the info. Surfing the waves of confusion, travelling over treacherous solitary conversation. It's about as much excitement as a mixed up individual such as yourself needs to keep the blood flowing. Drink another cup of rocket fuel and fly. Thank you. Just a little quiet one to calm down from that. And Karen Underhill's purse, if she's still in the building. Karen Underhill? Purse? Great. Okay. Yeah, just to come down from that hypomanic rant there about coffee addiction. Nice calm piece. It's called Ritual. Slice the bread and unbox the eggs. Quarter a tomato and pierce the plastic on an unhealthy pack of bacon sticks. Listen to the traffic coasting by, and listen to the bird song. Imagine you were anywhere but where you are, in the kitchen chopping mushrooms for your Sunday lunchtime fried. The fridge freezer, now a regular typecast character in your domestic scratchings, whirs into life and you jump with a start. A neighbour banging nails into a fence post, hands home, this day of rest. If you sort of dress like I do every day, sort of head to toe flat black, maybe your neighbours think the sort of rituals that you get involved in are of the darker persuasion. But this is a ritual that I don't perform very often, if I can help it. It's called gardening. Try waiting till 10 o'clock till all the neighbours have opened their curtains. Try getting the lawnmower through the kitchen to the front door without trailing dead grass everywhere. Try not to bark when asked, wouldn't it be better to keep your gardening tools in the garden shed? Try cutting the front grass without electrocuting yourself by leaving the flex and the mower's reverse path. Try strewing around rocky edging with a second-hand Black & Decker that cuts out every 40 seconds. Try brushing grass cuttings off the path with a plastic hand brush while a coarse nightingale blows them back again. Try tackling the back elephant grass, then whilst trimming gets splattered in the face with warm dog muck. Try doing any of the above and you too will only touch your garden once a flaming month. Joker, fraudster, waiting on the miracle. How do you get by? Don't you know you're faking all the things you can do and all the things you can't? All the things you're going to do and all the things you won't? The questions never asked, the fruits that go untasted, the feelings never checked, the waters left uncharted, bone solid idle. There's more to it than you will ever know. Get your backside into gear. You need working on. Fuck with boy. In writing, creative writing anyway, a lot of the time we're thinking, well, what if things weren't the way they are? What if it's a strong prompt for writing? You know, what if the moon really was made of cream cheese? And I was thinking one day, what if some of our best-loved musicians weren't rich and famous? What if they were really, really struggling? What if it was the poor poets who were living in mansions and the rock stars that had to sort of get arts grants and scrape by with audiences of 3 or 4? So with that in mind, I wrote this piece called Skins Old Mr. Melancholy Wears a Bird's Nest for a Crown. Some of you might get a couple of the references in here, it's very short. Robert's down on his luck. The 21st century teens don't like his lipstick smudge. He's hung out on Fascination Street far too long. Now it's time for the happy clappers to sing their little song. Bob's way beyond 40, his in-between days all gone. Sure, it's just like heaven when he closes his eyes. But when he opens his royalty check, listen to the cries. Alas, the NME awards ceremony was all a dream. And as for the comeback tour, sorry Mr. Smith, but there's no more money to be made in the cure. No sort of elongated poetry set would be complete without the obligatory love poem. So this is a little love poem for you, but it's a love poem with an edge. Ladies, as ever, I'm always on your side in these matters. And gentlemen, listen and learn. All of the dearest. So sorry we quarrelled the week before last. Sometimes I feel like jamming my tongue in a porphyry. So often my foot goes in my mouth and no one's to blame but me. I know I'm tired, I'm grouchy, the workload makes me weepy. You go have your knees up with the office boys, I'll visit Melissa. Nothing's spoiling, is there? I'm not a big, bad, scary head, silly Billy, I'm a girl. And it's not like I stabbed you, really. Caught me by surprise, just happened to be chopping onions at the time. A couple of stitches in the general and Bob's your mother's brother. Come on over, won't you, Oliver? Give me a ring. You send me a letter. Things will work out fine, I'm sure. Eventually, probably, maybe. Of course, it's a girl's prerogative to change her mind. Everyone knows that, and you should too, you stupid prat. Sometimes you can be so insensitive, so ignorant. I bet this letter sits crumpled in the arse pocket of those filthy letters for days. I know you think I'm going through more than just a phase when it's you who should learn to behave. Sneaking up behind me all hours of the day, curtains open wide for all and sundry walking by to see what a groping pig you can be. When I told you, no, no, no. I've got a headache, Oliver, and it's you. Don't you think you're God's gift? Well, maybe you're just not. Far from it, in fact. In fact, I'm not bloody sorry at all. Nap off back to Leicester for all I care. Move in with your sister, see how you fare. There, said it. Not sorry, not a sausage. Next time, it'll be the meat cleaver, and it won't be a finger. Love you not, your ex, Rachel. Good. This is a new piece, so I don't know how well it will go down. And it's basically just a commercial geared towards the complacent. I've just been to Edinburgh in the last week, and I don't do holidays very well. I'm not very good at doing holidays. This is called Calling Planet Affluent. Tired of those package deals every summer God sends. Bored of the poolside, the beach, the ingratiating tour guides, the tedious sightseeing. Come to hell on earth, it's got everything you need. Degeneration, air pollution, congestion, atrocious housing, knife crime, druggies, rapists, murderers, and for a totally unlimited time, rival gangs and teenage bastards terrorizing the neighborhood. Carjackers aplenty, ram raiding a speciality. So if you're bored to death this year, why not go the whole hog? Spend your final days in hell on earth. Call 666-2-for-1 for a brochure today, or visit www.youdon'tknowyoureborn.com. Thanks. That's quite dark, so just to lighten things up a bit, here's a little poem called Goth. I'm not with you in your shade of midnight leather pants. I'm not with you in a bunch of gloomy sycophants. I'm not with you in your Susie Sue top and platform boots. I'm not with you in your scarlet crimps with raven roots. I'm not with you in your coffin full of laughter. I'm not with you in your die young, live forever after. I'm not with you in your vampire entourage. I'm not with you, but God, I wish the hell I was. Thanks. What a lovely way to spend a Saturday afternoon this is. Thanks everyone for coming along. We've had some great music. We're going to have some more amazing music very shortly when I vacate the stage from Emergency Librarian. And I think there's some more poetry coming on after that. But great Saturday afternoon. So many Saturdays. So many Saturdays. We slip down the side street and scowl at the boy who gulps vinegar before folding into a doorway where the fumes of neglect infect us. We have failed to connect with our neighbours. It takes a lot to excite us of late. Some say we expect too much these days. This city gives little but takes lots. And if we are to follow our dreams, we must run faster towards the horizon. I've just got one more poem left for you. Thanks very much for your patience. I know half an hour is a long time to listen to one person doing poems. Oh, thanks very much. Thank you. Well, last year it was 25 minutes. Mark told me 40 minutes this year, so you never know. You might book me for an hour next time, which will make my head explode. Speaking of Mark, this is one of Mark's favourite pieces by me, and possibly because it's about a place where we both live, where we grew up.
Come on, back to this!
That's what it is, yeah. This poem, it's about mountain biking, it's about mental illness, and it's about the therapeutic benefits of keeping creative, writing a journal. I mentioned a place in this piece called Doctor's Wood. Doctor's Wood is a little area of woodland between two places in Concert where we live. You've got Black Hill and you've got Bridge Hill, and in between is a little bit of woodland. And it's so called Doctor's Wood because apparently a GP hung himself there, and his ghost is apparently haunts the wood. And when we were teenagers, kids would dare each other to go through Doctor's Wood and say, I bet you wouldn't go through Doctor's Wood on a dark night. But the scariest thing that we encountered were these steep slopes that we would ride our BMX bikes down. So with that in mind, this is just a page from my diary from a long time ago. It's called Coming Back to This. Thanks very much for listening. Coming back to this like you've never been away. The book in your hands, the light on your bare skin, the afternoon sun putting your window on the floor and you comfortably inside it. Coming back to this after an afternoon of old revisitations. One minute you were in Black Hill negotiating a sloped wall, not wanting to damage yourself or the bike. Another minute you were hammering over rough downhill terrain. The doctor's wood has hardly changed, save the overgrowth of nettles due to lack of daring teenagers riding the wall of death, and leaves flapping your arms in the face as you gently finger the brakes, anticipating an old tree root still lingering in the back of the mind. Coming back to this, Bridge Hill, Pemberton Road, the church car park, the black path. How could you forget the black path? Sledges in winter, skateboards high summer, cruising like a teenager in and out of cuts and back alleys, dropping off small walls, looking forward to being able to hop back onto them. Hey, it's like you've never been away, but too much is a good thing, yeah? And so back you cruise to home ground, dripping and full of fire, to haul the bike over the doorstep, put the kettle on, run the bath water. And after your long hot soak, he here you are again, relaxing by the window. Late afternoon sun soothing your aching limbs as you sip sweet tea and read sensations felt by some female soul on another part of the globe. Coming back to this, it's like you've never been away. All the agony of a breakdown, the months of hospital appointments and therapy. A mere blip, barely worth mentioning. But coming back to this for a moment or two at least helps put things in perspective. Thank your lucky stars for endurance. Thank your lucky stars for mountain bikes and poetry. The birds sing and the seconds tick away at the edge of the table. Coming back to this, you will always find yourself coming back to this. Thanks very much for listening and enjoy the rest of the day. Cheers. Thanks very much.
Oops, sorry, I hope you mean to say that word just for me. Massively, brilliantly, fabulously, gigantic hands for Steve Urwin!
Thank you!
What a brilliant performer he is. Thank you for staying and experiencing the wonderfulness of Never Mind The Ramones. Very, 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 very shortly we will have emergency librarian live on stage! Yeah, prepare to be totally mesmerised and have all of your brains stuck all over the wall and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. I'm just such a big fan of this band. And you will be too, after you've experienced the wonderfulness of Emergency Librarian! To the charity, the concept, so please put all the spare change, please put all your £10 notes into the bucket. With some wonderful merchandise over on the right hand side, Steve Urwin has some books for sale at very reasonable prices, but of course you know, you'll pay any money to acquire any of his material. Emergency Librarian have some limited edition tapes of their fabulously excellent music for sale for only £5 per tape. Or, special offer, £2 for £10. Yeah. Unless you have to get that product. Yeah. Bargain! There's very few cakes left on Jane's store. She's been very creative in the display of them. And I'm very glad that she's nearly sold out. Get them while they're still available. And there's still time to purchase some lovely soaps from Laura at the back, some fabulous jewellery, and some fabulous goods from Andrew and Beth, and from the very wonderful Spotted Humbert store, just over on the left hand side here. We've still got some CDs and DVDs and things from XLR stock. And if there's any badge acetates left, you can get a fabulous badge from the Inches at the back there. Next up, Emergency Library!
Slightly to the left. Yep. The whole tape will allow some bits of the string without your goggles.